It is May 15th on this Sunday, Global Transmission. David Knight is going to be co-hosting from the studio. I am here on the road. If we attempt to decipher and expose the lies that the establishment media puts out and that big corporations, the government puts out every day, our job would be impossible. There's not enough hours. There's not enough reporters in the world to be able to actually chronicle and track the full spectrum of disinformation and fraud that is spewed at the people of the United States and the world. Now, the good news is the Associated Press, I talked a lot about this, did a big poll last month and found that only 6% of people that follow mainstream media trust it. But still, people don't trust it, but because there is no real news in many cases now, nothing but spin, they don't know what's going on. I don't believe the earth is flat, but if the mainstream media started saying it was round, I might question them. I mean, that's how deceptive these people are, that you really can't believe anything they say. They taint, they twist, they spin. So in the first 30 minutes today, I want to go over a few examples of this in context of the news, just to show the hypocrisy, the fraud, the disinformation. So here's some of what's coming up after the break. Look at this, New York Times. Crossing the line, how Donald Trump behaved with women in private. Interviews reveal unwelcome advances, a shrewd reliance on ambition, and unsettling workplace conduct over decades, like telling women they're attractive. See, there's no bigger crime than men and women together, like fathers and mothers, or he or she. That's all being attacked. That sacred bond between men and women, the human species, cuddling together in the dark for eons. And it's now just horrible. No one ever said sexual harassment. No one ever said rape like the Clintons. No one ever made any of these connections. But you know what? They found a few women that said that, you know, he told them that they should lose weight decades ago. And oh my God, it was so horrible. So it's okay for China to have suicide nets around the Foxconn labs where Apple has its products made. It's okay for Beyonce, it's come out, you know, getting her products made in literal slave labor shops. That's all right. As long as they virtue signal that they love you and they care about you. So I'm going to be breaking all that down. Remember, Bono's foundations pay over 1% or less than 1%. It varies. Some are like 1.1, some are like 0.3. He gets billions at these big concerts, gets paid, and then gives 1% on average to the charities. But people don't care. It's like, oh my God, you're a total con artist. And that ties into George Clooney, the galactic con artist fop, who can't even get one line out without stumbling around. It's all coming up after the break. But remember the pedophile planes that the Clintons flew on, and that Clinton was going off to that pedo island with Epstein. None of that's in the news. There's not a New York Times article about that confirmed. No. Or all the rape victims Clinton settled with. No. It's all about how Donald Trump had beauty pageants with pretty girls, and when he wasn't married sometimes, he had hot girlfriends. What would happen if the species, males and females, got together? It's so aberrant. It's so sick to have a high-powered billionaire wanting beautiful, hot women. I mean, it's just, it's degenerate. Because in a world where Caitlyn Jenner is God and stunning and brave, well, the beauty pageants aren't allowed. And meanwhile, we can't even discuss Epstein's pedophile island and the Clintons. It just goes on and on. Big broadcast today. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And wait till I play Watson's report on the fact that George Clooney can go F himself. Thank you for joining us on this live, original Sunday worldwide broadcast. David Knight will be coming up in studio at the bottom of the hour. I'm Alex Jones. Now, we're going to be looking at the latest news, geopolitical developments, what's happening in the economy, campaign trail 2016 today. But I wanted to focus in at the start of the broadcast with just some really sterling examples of the most flagrant, disgusting hypocrisy I've ever seen in my life. In fact, hypocrisy isn't the word, a war on reality. The cover of the New York Times on Friday and throughout the weekend is Donald Trump at one of his beauty pageants years ago. And they're basically saying the crime is that he's a man who is around beautiful women. And once in the 80s, told a woman she might want to lose some weight to be a model, and she was depressed. So just being a male is evil, is bad. They're literally banning mother and father, he, she, and, you know, colleges. This is a war on the biology of humans. This is a war on our basic units so that we become cogs in a machine that can just be programmed. But just, here's a few examples of hypocrisy right now. They go in, they demonize Trump here. It's all over the news. This is the new talking point. You know, vote for Hillary. She stands up for women when she covers up all the rapes and stuff of Bill. And as Bill settles all these rape cases over the years. Here's Fox News, though. The New York Times didn't report on this. Flight logs show Bill Clinton flew on sex offender's jet much more than previously known. That's Jeffrey Epstein. Epstein. His Boeing 727. And went to the Pleasure Pedo Island. Now, this is all well known. Okay? So, what did they do 2 weeks ago? They put out a false lawsuit report that a woman who claimed she was at Epstein's Island had been abused by Trump. It later found out it was a fake name, fake lawsuit filing. Just, that's because Roger Stone and myself and others are promoting Stone's book that exposes Jeffrey Epstein and all the crap they're involved in and the Clintons. So then, oh, Donald Trump, he did that too with some Jane Doe. So this is how they operate. Okay, so the New York Times should be on this, shouldn't they? But no. Neither will Megyn Kelly. They're all going to just, you know, the new gimmick. We've had the black president, now the female president. And then that brings me to this newest piece of propaganda that we're going to cover and play here in just a moment. I mean, you've got to watch how incredibly arrogant and ridiculous this Clooney clip is when he's telling folks Donald Trump isn't going to be elected, trying to act all intellectual, and then he has to look down at his notes and can't even remember what he's saying. This is all bought and paid for. Here it is.
Yeah, President Donald Trump. That's not going to happen. And it's not going to happen because we're not going to be used. Fear is not going to be something that we're going to, that's going to be what drives our country. We're not going to be scared of Muslims or immigrants or, you know, women.
The worst thing about...
Okay, now we're going to play his full report here in just about a minute, Paul Watson's report. And I had to bleep a few things because of potty talk. I hear for FCC rules, but I understand Watson's anger. And I'm going to focus more on Hollywood and more on the hypocrisy of these people. Because Clooney has all these armed guards, but he wants to ban your guns. This guy has giant palatial manors all over the place in Europe, but is saying bring in more refugees and have poor people pay for it. It's all about this fake justice signaling, virtue signaling, that they're all high and mighty. Just like, again, Bono, U2, just type in U2 charity scam, where he gives less than 1%. Of billions he raises, and when he got criticized, he started giving like 1.2%. And he goes and says, this is for Africans, this is for AIDS victims, this is for, and he gets like sometimes $1 billion in a concert from TV rights, everything, and he just keeps 99% of it. But it's okay because he's liberal and goes, and they're all just reading off teleprompters. You know, Clooney, if you're a radio listener, was looking down. He goes, my notes here. It's ridiculous. These people can't even say one sentence originally. They have no souls. It's disgusting. So I want to focus in on these people's hypocrisy. I want to focus in on the things that they're pushing and really just realize that they're monsters posing as if they're liberal egalitarians that want to help society. How long do we have, Buckley, do we go this clip?
Too many seconds.
All right, well... I've got so much I want to say here, but let's just go to the Paul Joseph Watson clip. The full video is on Infowars.com. You got to see it for yourself if you're a radio listener. And we're going to come back from break and analyze this more. But this is just outrageous, outrageous how arrogant these people are.
There's not going to be a President Donald Trump. That's not going to happen. And it's not going to happen because we're not going to be used. Fear is not going to be something that we're going to, that's going to be what drives our country. We're not going to be scared of Muslims or immigrants or, you know, women.
The worst thing about George Clooney isn't the unremitting bull that streams out of his mouth. It's the way he always acts as if he's got the moral high ground. You don't have the moral high ground.
around.
You're supporting one of the most corrupt politicians in generations. You're supporting a woman who took $100 million from Gulf State dictators, countries responsible for some of the worst human rights abuses on the planet. You're supporting a woman who's in bed with Saudi Arabia, a country that bankrolled ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and was involved in 9/11.
Trump is actually a result, in many ways, of the fact that much of the news programs didn't follow up and ask tough questions. That's the truth.
Really? So if Trump wasn't asked hard questions, why do studies show that he got the most negative coverage out of any Republican candidate?
You know, the ratings go up because they can show up empty podiums saying Donald Trump is about to speak. Yeah. You know, as opposed to taking those 30 seconds and saying, well, let's talk about refugees, which is the biggest crisis that's going on in the world right now.
Okay, George, let's talk about the refugees, because it makes complete sense that you would throw your support behind Saudi Arabia's preferred candidate. You see, Clooney and the Saudis have a lot in common when it comes to refugees. They both whine and bitch about refugees all day long, while taking in precisely zero refugees. Saudi Arabia has 100,000 air-conditioned tents with bathroom and kitchen facilities that can house 3 million people sitting empty for most of the year. How many Syrian refugees have the Saudis taken in? None. George Clooney visits Angela Merkel to lecture Europe about how they're not doing enough for Muslim migrants, despite accepting millions of them over the past year. How many Syrian refugees has George Clooney taken in? None. Zero, nada, zilch. The guy's got 5 frigging mansions, 3 of which are in Europe. He's just bought another one in Britain for £10 million. Clooney and his wife have got room for a new swimming pool, a home cinema, a library, a steam room, a spa, a gym, a wine cellar, and 8 empty bedrooms. But no room for any refugees. So Clooney, when are you gonna do your bit for the refugees you care so deeply about? Or is this just one long, tiresome exercise in virtue signalling? I wonder. How dare you lecture Germans about accepting more refugees from the comfort of your $100 million Lake Como villa, while people in villages like Sumte, with a population of little over 100, are inundated by 750 unassimilated Muslim migrants.
We've lost the ability to get to and tell the truth and get to the facts.
Seriously, this is a guy who throws $350,000 a plate fundraisers for Hillary, and then has the nerve to get on TV the next day to complain about getting big money out of politics. This is a guy who lectures Hollywood about diversity, yet whose new movie doesn't feature one single black actor. He's a total hypocrite, and I'm sick of seeing his smug, self-satisfied face spewing out meaningless platitudes while the media makes out like he's Jesus f***ing Christ. Clooney once angrily lectured a journalist who called one of his movies boring. You make a lot of films yourself, yeah? I'd like to see you make a film before you get to talk about it. What a jerk, said Clooney. Well, I'd like to see you listen to the parents of women and children raped by Muslim migrants in Europe before you get to talk about it. I'd like to see you house a single Syrian refugee in one of your numerous palatial mansions before implying that we're all racist for expressing concern about the millions of Muslim migrants pouring into Europe. George Clooney is a total prick. George Clooney.
It's AlexJonesInfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Now, I want to show you some Orwellian stories that are in mainstream news that we talked about and I made a film about back in 1999 called Police Take 2000. And that is the federal government funding microphones to be put up by the thousands per city in parks, you name it, to listen to the people. And of course, it's way beyond that now, but it's finally in the news. They have, you know, fake light poles and the rest of this, and this is going on. But our borders are open, and we're shipping in radical Muslims and not even vetting them, and not even making sure they have real passports. And then Trump says, until we vet people, we got to cut it off. Well, I thought nobody could come here unless they had a valid passport. I can't go to Germany or China if I don't have a valid passport. But oh, here, if it's for illegals or jihadis, they get in, it's in the news, without even showing anything. But Donald Trump's a hater. See, and I'm not even defending Donald Trump here. But the way they invert reality, the way they twist that over and over again is simply mind-blowing. and just staggers the mind that they've gotten to this point. Well, now let's go over some of these articles. Again, Jeffrey Epstein, flight log show Bill Clinton flew on sex offender's jet, and this was the Lolita Express, the Pleasure Island he went to. I mean, this is all well known. It's well documented. Just type in Clinton's and Jeffrey Epstein, and then you get it all right here. It's just hundreds of articles, but nothing in the New York Times. Nothing in the New York Times about any of this. When this guy is hanging around with your 12 and 13-year-old daughters, okay? I mean, it's just simply amazing. Look at this freaking predator right here. I mean, just look at these people. And they are just feeding on everyone. Oh my gosh, Donald Trump, did you hear? He dated lots of women, and he would come up and actually say, "You're hot, I want to go out with you." They say it's a microaggression, the New York Times. He would actually just brashly say, "Hey, let's go out to dinner." Imagine like an old-fashioned guy, I mean, whoa. That is a crime. But I tell you, if you've got a Pleasure Island with lots of little kidnapped little girls, it's okay, because, it's liberal. It's all right. Now, since I mentioned this, I just want to show you, if you're a radio listener, TV viewer, Daily Mail is just one article. Just type in Bono's charity scams, and you'll get hundreds of articles. Foundation under fire for giving a little over 1% of funds to charity. And then you can find other articles for these other charities where he raises hundreds of millions, billions, tens of billions over the years, and the son of a bitch. And I'm sorry, that's not fair to his mother or anybody else. That's not fair to bastards. I'm serious. I know a lot of great bastards. I'm serious. What do you call these monsters that run around acting like they're liberal and loving? And if any other charity did anything close to this, they'd be arrested. I mean, United Way got in trouble for keeping half the money, and I think that's a scandal. And other groups, have been caught, giving the charity money to gun control groups. But this guy gives less than 1%, gets criticized, gives a little bit more than 1%, and he just keeps running these charities that are government-sponsored because it's all a big scam, like the Clinton Foundation with the Bushes. And it's bipartisan scams. But here it is. Now, continuing, since I mentioned this, hidden microphones exposed as part of government surveillance program, CBS San Francisco Bay Area. And then it just goes into how they have these hidden microphones everywhere, and they're listening to people. And again, the FBI is breaking into your OnStar without a warrant, your webcams without a warrant. I usually have mine covered, but I'm over here at somebody else's, so I guess they've got theirs open. And we've got this article, Think Progress Praises Obamacare Thievery, Curtin Emmo, Infowars.com, declares program a success as judge rules it unconstitutional. It's a tax to predominantly foreign megabanks that own the insurance companies. Their profits in the first year of Obamacare globally, just off our backs, went up 47%. Look it up. You want me to show you? Just like Warren Buffett's the big liberal philanthropist, he wants to raise taxes on the rich. He writes the loopholes where he's exempt. The rich are people making $100,000 a year. He wants all their money for another banker bailout. Warren Buffett, the biggest supporter of the banker bailout, the biggest recipient, McClatchy. Look it up. I mean, again, it's just the thievery is so over the top, so galactic, so gargantuan, so incredible that they get away with it because they ask for the moon. And people don't even know how to respond. It's like these are criminals too big to fail. So they're swallowing the whole world up here. And they have so-called liberal groups talking about how it's free and wonderful and you keep your doctor. None of it's true. We have Gruber that wrote it with Obama admitting it's all a screw job and calling people dumb and thank God Americans are stupid and everybody's prices are going way up and everything's collapsing. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's the Think Progress people. I've got cool little beards and, lots of tattoos. And I'm not bashing if you got tattoos, but you know what I mean. It's like you don't need an intellect or anything as long as you have mismatched random tattoos all over your body and, have a big beard for the movie The Hangover. Okay, continuing here. Preppers say Obama has divided us on a course to civil war. Abso-frickin-lutely, that is the globalist plan in triplicate, in spades, on every single front. And it's time to start calling out the hypocrisy for what it is. We've had Obama and Hillary tell England, the UK, you better stay in the euro. Don't go the path of the Nazis. We've had James Cameron, their prime minister, say, this nationalism, has the smack of Nazism. And I've been pointing out for months The EU plan was a brainchild of Albert Speer, the German Interior Ministry, later head of armaments, Hitler's architect, Hermann Göring, and Adolf Hitler. And how they would control people through economics and through central banks, and how they would even jack the food and water to dumb down the sub-races, in their own words. And boy, they turned us all into a sub-race now with the fluoride and all this stuff. I was out today with my kids having some breakfast. Only people have been, like, shot with a mutation gun. And I'm not some arrogant Mr. Beautiful person. I mean, people look sick, weird, crazy, of every race, color, and creed, just stumbling around aimlessly. Most of the kids I saw looked like they had Down syndrome or other chromosomal disorders or were autistic. I mean, we're dead already. Let me tell you, the Third Reich didn't lose, folks. The globalists had actually just tested it in Germany. The Third Reich came from London and D.C., but that's in my film Endgame. The point is, the good news is, even the liberal outgoing mayor of London has come out and said that the EU wants a super state just as Hitler did. And then they got the EU criticizing him, saying it's very distasteful and very, very hurtful that he said that. Well, it's an absolute fact, okay? It is an absolute, incontrovertible fact that all of this is going on. And that what was left of the Nazis and others met at Bilderberg in Utrecht, Holland, to basically set up a transatlantic deal. Bilderberg has released their first minutes from 54. I mean, you understand, most of what I talk about is their own admissions, like 99%. And that they would establish a global fascistic system through economic control to get control of nations and then cut off the resources. This is economic takeover. Infowars.com, folks, is the tip of the spear. We have David Knight coming up and more. And I'll be calling in as well. Joe Biggs is popping in. All the breaking news and more straight ahead. If you're watching or listening to this transmission, you are the hope, folks. Please take action. We've been captured by globalists. It's illegitimate. Let's speak out against it and stop it.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today for the rest of the live show here on this Sunday, May 15th, 2016. We have a lot of news. I'm not really sure where I want to start because we've got information about how the blueprint has been unfolding for over 2,400 years. We're now starting to see this come to fruition. And when I saw this story about synthetic DNA this weekend, it made me, of course, there's obvious parallels to Brave New World. Of course, there's obvious parallels in Brave New World to Plato's Republic and the agenda that they had there. But we can see in so many different ways how sophisticated this is becoming. And how even something that was an Orwellian scientific technocracy nightmare when I was in high school, something like Brave New World, that's kind of becoming passé. The technology that's there right now has potential for things that even the worst dystopian novels did not imagine in my early lifetime. Something we really have to think about. You know, as we're talking about what's going on and what's before us in this election, a lot of people say, well, you know, I don't like Donald Trump because he's not strong enough or centered enough or focused enough or articulate enough about individual liberty. It's like, well, where do we have that codified? Well, it's in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. If we lose our nation, are we going to have a Bill of Rights? Are we going to have the best charter of individual liberties that anybody has ever seen? Of course, it's being ignored, and we'll talk about that constantly. There's more evidence about that today. But the bottom line is that the people who rule over us take an oath to the Constitution. And as long as they take an oath to the Constitution, as long as that blueprint is there, we still have hopes that we can enforce that someday. But if that's removed and we're taken away and we're subsumed into some other government that just replaces that or nullifies that officially, then we have a much, much deeper problem. But if we keep the nation state, if we survive in this contest of nationalism versus globalism, as Senator Sessions has pointed out many times, of course, his former chief of staff, who is now Trump's senior policy advisor, Stephen Miller, has pointed this out. If we survive in this fight of nationalism versus globalism, there is another fight that we will have within the nation, and that is the government versus the family. I know a lot of you are going to say, oh, it should be the government versus the individual. Yeah, it's true. But you know what? They want to begin controlling you at birth. They want to begin controlling you before birth. We can see this in this story that comes out today where they start talking about synthetic DNA. The control with them will start from the very beginning, where they will design the citizens and the different classes within their society. That's when it will begin. Of course, it will run through that with the other ancient tools of control, education. That was what Plato was depending on, was education. And of course, that is part of the tool. We always talk about nature versus nurture debate. How much of what we are the experiences that we have, and how much of it is the hardwired DNA? And of course, they work together. Remember movies like The Boys from Brazil? We had Joseph Mengele going in and reproducing genetically a lot of little Adolf Hitlers, and then trying to make sure so he would get exactly the same guy, trying to make sure that their life experiences mirrored or lined with what Adolf Hitler had gone through in his early life. So there's both of those are there, nature and nurture. And they have been trying to control this from the very beginning, as I point out. There's been a long history of political elites plotting on how they are going to implement this. The goals have not changed in 2,500 years. Understand that. Okay? This is a struggle. It is a political struggle. It is a spiritual struggle. The goals do not change, but the techniques do. And the technology is getting truly powerful. The technology that will allow them to leverage this. And so when we talk about how they're going to control the individual, they always go to controlling the family. Because as I pointed out, they want to control you from even before birth, but certainly as early as possible. Don't you hear this all the time from the central planners, whether they're Democrats or Republicans? We need early childhood involvement and so forth and so on to make sure they turn out right. Well, you know what? It's not about teaching your kids reading and writing and arithmetic. They have a different agenda. And so we can see that with just these bathroom wars. They try to trivialize it. We've got Alan Grayson from Florida laughing about how trivial this is. Well, you know what? It's not trivial. We understand precisely what's behind it. Yeah, they try to divide people along these different issues. And if you get caught up in all the dog whistles that they use out there about sexual orientation or race or culture or language, then you don't really see the big picture. Now, before I get into that, let me start out by talking about Sheriff Joe. This article came out this last weekend. They're now continually moving against Sheriff Joe because they don't want anyone who is going to stand in the way of their open borders, because that's part of what they're doing right now to engineer the takedown of our societies. You have to understand that this is something that began as soon as Obama took office in 2009, March 9th, 2009. He'd only been in office maybe about, five, 6 weeks or something after he took oath of office. Arizona had passed a law, a state law, back 2004, 2005, the Coyote Law. And what that did was that allowed state law enforcement officers to come after the people who were smuggling, who were doing human trafficking, the coyotes. It also labeled as accessories the people who were paying them to do the human smuggling. And that had been going on for 4 or 5 years. And as soon as Obama administration comes in, they start to come after Sheriff Joe about this. And let me say, when I talk about Sheriff Joe, I have had people send me emails when I talk and read quotes from John Adams and say, don't you understand that John Adams did the Alien and Sedition Act? It's like, yeah, I understand John Adams did that. Do you understand that there's nobody who's perfect? Thomas Jefferson owned slaves, but he gave us one of the best defenses against slavery and for individual rights. So you have these internal conflicts with these guys. You have this personal hypocrisy, but it doesn't take away from the general principles that they lay down. And when somebody does the right thing, just like Ron Wyden, when he comes out and exposes the dragnet surveillance that's being conducted on our country by the NSA illegally, unconstitutionally, criminally, and he asks James Clapper, and James Clapper rubs his forehead and goes, well, I can't really say anything about it. You know, look, when that happens, good for Ron Wyden. I don't agree with him on anything else, but I will say good for Ron Wyden. He exposed this guy. He caught him in a public area and had him essentially lie to everybody. And then that was exposed in spades a few months later when we had the Snowden leaks. And Michael Hayden, former director of the NSA, the CIA, just cannot contain his contempt for Ron Wyden. He says, Ron Wyden knew that we were doing that. He knew that he was going to put James Clapper in a tough spot where he's going to have to lie to the public It's like, yeah, that's why he did it. That's right. Good for him. Good for him because you, sir, Michael Hayden, you were violating your oath to the Constitution. You were doing things for which you ought to be put in jail. And you're angry because the senator knew that you were doing illegal dragnet surveillance, which neither the Constitution nor even your Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act authorize you to do. And so he exposed that. So when I talk about Sheriff Joe, yeah, I understand he's a police, he's a sheriff and the cops. When you look at any cops, you're going to always find in a police department, you're going to find histories of abuse. You're going to find things that went wrong, that went south. You're going to have SWAT team issues. You got that with Arpaio. You got a lot of things that I don't approve of, that I don't agree with. A lot of things that were swept under the carpet. That's going to be the case when you look at any law enforcement officer, pretty much. But let's understand that what he's doing is he's trying to protect the community there from the open border situation. And the criminals who are coming in, they're vetting these people who are coming in illegally, illegally. They are not just justice-involved individuals. Have you heard that? Have you heard that euphemism? I didn't even notice this. This is a couple of weeks now that the Obama administration has been using this euphemism, justice-involved individuals. We've got Loretta Lynch Mob as well as Obama talking about justice-involved individuals. No, they're not criminals. They're not convicts. They're justice-involved. And so, you know, when they come in and they say Sheriff Joe is being racist, he's profiling people, it's like, well, are you being racist? Are you profiling people when you say that we're discriminating against blacks and Hispanics because they're convicted criminals? We'll talk about that when we come back. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Sunday, May 15th, 2016. You know, I just saw the movie Armageddon this last weekend, and we've got a report from Leanne McAdoo there at the red carpet premiere of Armageddon. And then I come home and I look at what's going on in Venezuela, the apocalypse that is happening there. Of course, we have an article that is up on Infowars.com. It's linked by Drudge, showing a lot of videos as well as breaking down what's really happening there. It's absolutely incredible. And you look at that, you look at the movie that we just saw, it's absolutely amazing to see how society is being engineered to come down. Of course, what's happening there in Venezuela has been very predictable. It's been unfolding for many years. As one person who is very wealthy was asked by someone when he went bankrupt, they said, how did you go bankrupt? You had so much money. They said, well, gradually, then suddenly. And so now we are seeing this accelerate inside Venezuela. We're seeing this increase in Venezuela. And before I, and let me read a little bit before I go back to what I was talking about in terms of what's happening with synthetic DNA and where that shows us where these people are headed. Let me just read you a couple of reviews that I got from people leaving comments about Armageddon. One person said, we want more movies addressing these very issues. The movie was original, so pure, and its intent so innocent, too honest to be wise. I applaud everyone involved in making this. That was a common theme. A lot of people are very grateful that Gary Haven and Mike Norris put their time, their money on the line to make a movie that put these messages out there, things that people really need to think about. Another one said the theater was absolutely packed. The crowd cheered many scenes and statements made in the movie concerning returning to American values, morality, Texas secession, etc. So did I. The message was incredibly powerful. People are so hungry for the truth, they said, and movies about these issues and freedom are what people are looking for. They said you could put it on dog food and we would still eat it. Said, I love the people who made this film. I know it was an intense labor of love, a message intended to awaken and save America. There's never been a movie like this. I applaud the work and thank you for fighting the good fight. Fighting is winning. That is absolutely true. And I think it's a great beginning for movies like this. I think that as they do this, if they get some financial success, we'll see more and movies with bigger budgets that come out over a period of time. I think we'll see that there certainly is an audience for that. We've seen that happen with Christian films, and this is something there is an audience for that Hollywood is not going to make, or they'll put their own spin on it. That's why they did it individually. And when I look at that, when I look at what's going on in Venezuela, we've got, as the article we had up on InfoWars says, over the past several years, we've documented with clockwork regularity Venezuela's collapse into a failed nation state status. And said, here's where you know that it ended. Remember, Margaret Thatcher said, with socialism, you eventually run out of other people's money. Well, this is the way he put it here. He said, we knew that they were at rock bottom when it was reported that Venezuela had run out of money to print money. Okay, so you not only run out of other people's money, but you don't even have the money to print the worthless paper for which there's nothing behind it. And so then they have pictures and movies of what's happening in various locations. There's one location where they got 5,000 people who lined up and absolutely rioted. They took milk, pasta, flour, oil, milk powder, because these are government stores. And you can see there the crowd lined up against the police who are there trying to protect the government distribution centers, because it is a centrally planned command control economy run by a bunch of kleptocrats, a bunch of thieves. People like Hugo Chavez, people like Maduro, people like the Sandinistas that Bernie Sanders loves so much, Bernie Sandinista. They point out our food dispensaries are run by the government, and they were looted by the people as well. When over, how many times do we see this? Of course, the same type of thing that we saw happen back in the old Soviet Union. People would hear that there's food at a particular place. Hey, the gum store down the street has got bananas, so everybody goes down there and queues up for bananas. And there's another store somewhere else. They've got some sausage. Everybody goes there to get the sausages. That's what's happening. They've got people who are hunting down dogs and cats in the street. They say the country's got about 15 days left of inventory and food. Okay, it's getting really bad. But we've talked about this before, haven't we? This is a story going back to 2014, June 2014. 2 years ago, Bloomberg. Venezuela sacrifices drinking water in order to pay bondholders. They say at a time when Venezuela's, this is 2 years old, at a time when Venezuela's record $25 billion in arrears to importers has its citizens waiting hours in line to buy drinking water and having to cross borders to get medicine, President Maduro is using the nation's dwindling supply of dollars to enrich bondholders. This is 2 years ago. So now it is literally rioting in the streets to try to get food and water. Now, what they were talking about at the time, which is truly amazing, they say Maduro's predecessor, Hugo Chavez, kept up payments to bondholders, allowing them to reap returns of 692%. 692% return on investment during his 14-year tenure. And they say, we're confident that his successor is going to play nice with Wall Street as well. Yeah, I'm sure he will, because it's the bankers who love to create socialism. We have this dichotomy, just as these liberals, these socialist controllers, and I hate to call them liberals because we used to indicate people who believed in individual and economic freedom. And then they stole that word. And that's what they do, is they play with the language and they play with defining the groups. And so what we see happening is they try to tell us that there's the Wall Street bankers, and then there's the good guy socialists like Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton. And we got this article today. We need diversity at the Fed. And they're not calling for the Fed to be monitored or to be audited or this private organization to be shut down. No, they're saying, you know what we need to do to fix this is we need to make sure that we have the voices of women, of African Americans and Latinos at the Fed so that we serve their interests too. Look, you can find some puppet of every one of those demographic groups, and you can find puppets who will go there and sit on the boards and put on a nice little facade for the public that, hey, isn't this great? We now have diversity at the Fed, and it isn't going to change anything about the way this organization is run. The Fed and these central bankers hide behind communists, and they do the sorts of things that they're doing in Venezuela right now. And so the bottom line is, folks, if we don't wake up and see this, what you're seeing happening now in Venezuela is going to happen here. So all the more reason for you to start learning how to take care of your family. That's a takeaway when you watch a movie like Armageddon. That's a takeaway. Understand and think about the different ways that you need to prepare. And, of course, we have a lot of preparedness products that we sell as a win-win situation. It's what we do to help fund the organization here. One of the sales that we've got right now, we still continued 30 to 40% off our best-selling InfoWars Select Storable Foods. You can find that now at InfoWarsStore.com. This isn't going to last much longer. We did have 30 to 40% off all the select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. That's now been limited to just our best-selling products, and that's not going to last much longer. We also now have back in stock Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink. That's a mix that you can add to water or to carbonated water. It's a great-tasting multivitamin supplement. And you can find that now back in stock. We got that originally, and it sold out pretty quick, and we've got another limited run. That will also sell out pretty quickly at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, as I was just talking about the lies from Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders saying that they're now going to be focused on diversity for the Fed and not really focused on what the Fed is doing, take a look at how the DNC boss, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, is covering for Hillary Clinton. When she says, and she keeps repeating and has been doing this for quite some time, everybody asks her, what about this? Oh, it's not an investigation. They're simply reviewing security procedures. And we've had the FBI push back against this. He says, no, that's not what we do. Investigations are what we do. Remember the Federal Bureau of Investigations, not the Federal Bureau of Security Reviews. I want to play for you what Debbie Wasserman Schultz said.
There is a security inquiry going on. And, you know, we respect that. It is on its own timetable, but it's moving forward. The Justice Department has the emails. They have the server. They're conducting a security inquiry.
I say what I've said now for many, many months. It's a security inquiry.
So when that question was posed to the FBI director this week, James Comey said, I don't know what that means. We are conducting an investigation. That's the Bureau's business. That's what we do. I'm not familiar with the term security inquiry. Is she taking this as seriously as the FBI is?
Well, I think it's important to underscore that Secretary Clinton isn't even a target of this inquiry, investigation, whatever I word you want to use.
Whatever I word you want to use, yeah. She's just kind of justice involved in this. We'll have more of that when we come back. We're going to play a special report from John Bowne as well. Stay with us.
In the 1950s, Khrushchev predicted, we will bury you. But in the West today, we see a free world that has achieved a level of prosperity and well-being unprecedented in all human history. In the communist world, we see failure, technological backwardness, declining standards of health. We welcome change and openness, for we believe that freedom and security go together, that the advance of human liberty can only strengthen the cause of world peace. General Secretary Gorbachev, if you seek peace, if you seek prosperity for the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, if you seek liberalization, come here to this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, open this gate.
This was the moment when the finesse of foreign policy rewarded a more peaceful existence for humanity. Bold words in the face of fading tensions.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
And now those old tensions are reanimating and the nuclear saber-rattling is getting louder. NATO's anti-missile defense system, based in Romania, went live last week, and Poland is preparing to break ground on another NATO anti-missile defense base. Meanwhile, the Navy Times reports Russian pilots rattled nerves aboard the destroyer Donald Cook, buzzing within yards of the ship in the Baltic Sea. Provocative? Sure, but they weren't a credible threat. So concludes a retired Navy commanding officer when unarmed Sukhoi Su-24 fighters flew within 1,000 feet of the ship, once coming as close as 30 feet in what U.S. officials called simulated attacks. On Monday, a low-flying Russian Ka-27 Helix helicopter also appeared to take photos of the ship. And in February, the Express UK reported Russian bear bombers spotted flying close to UK airspace could be carrying atomic warheads, sparking fears over the potential fallout of a crash or accident involving the aging Soviet-era warplanes. The Daily Signal reported in December of 2015, Russia is developing a drone submarine that can deliver a nuclear warhead or dirty bomb at U.S. coastal areas. Russian officials confirmed the existence of the program, dubbed Canyon by the Pentagon, after images of a document detailing plans for the sub were broadcast on Russian state-run television. According to the document, Canyon is intended to be capable of damaging the important components of adversaries' economy in a coastal area, and inflicting unacceptable damage to a country's territory by creating areas of wide radioactive contamination that would be unsuitable for military, economic, or other activity for long periods of time. And while the U.S. fights over transgender bathrooms, Moscow has been shouting their intense disapproval of the U.S. NATO anti-missile bases from the rooftops. The New York Times reports, Russian officials reiterated their position that the American-built system imperiled Russia's security. But the public discussion in Russia was darker, including online commentary of how a nuclear confrontation might play out in Europe and the prospect that Romania, the system's host, might be reduced to smoking ruins. And Putin wants everyone to know he isn't bluffing. Today, Putin warned that Russia would take the necessary steps to end threats from the U.S. NATO anti-missile systems going live on Russia's doorstep. On May 10th, the Daily Mail reported, Russia is preparing to test a nuclear missile which is so advanced it could get past NATO defenses and decimate a large slice of Europe within seconds of launching. The RS-28 Sarmat missile, dubbed Satan II by NATO, has a top speed of 4.3 miles per second and has been designed to outfox anti-missile shield systems. The Kremlin's new intercontinental ballistic missile will be ready for field trials this summer. For the moment, all of this failed foreign policy lies in the double-crossing hands of a New World Order U.S. president.
Okay, and that's John Bowne's report, and you can see that at Alex Jones's YouTube channel. Of course, it's not just missiles that they're talking about releasing. They're talking about releasing Hillary Clinton's missives. Do you think that the Russians have her emails? You bet they do. They've got more than 20,000 of them. They're talking about whether or not they should release those or not. Let them fly. Okay, we'll be right back. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host, and we're going to take some of your calls today on this Sunday. Here's the number. It's a different number on Sunday, 877-789-2539. That's 877-789-ALEX. If you want to join into the show and with your comments and questions, just before we went to break at the top of the hour, we played that clip from Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the DNC chair, also close ally of Hillary Clinton, covering for her, saying that, no, she's not being investigated. It's a security review. Well, that's not what the FBI head says. That's not what James Comey says, the FBI director. He says, no, we don't do security reviews. We do investigations. And as I mentioned at the end of that segment where John Bowne was talking about the restart of the Cold War, something that the United States very deliberately did, because, you know, there's a lot of money to be made in a Cold War. We've got the military-industrial complex just aching to do those big-ticket items, those intercontinental ballistic missiles, long-range bombers, the ships, all that stuff. And, of course, the Russians, that's the lifeblood of the state, any state, especially the militaristic states. They want to see it, too. So both of them are going back and forth and escalating things. But it's always a concern, because you never know when somebody is going to go over the top. You never know when you're going to have some individual in one country or the other that decides that they want to destroy that country, just as we see Obama and Hillary Clinton and the Democrats trying to destroy this country. And let's make no doubt about it, folks. That is what's happening now. You know, Debbie Wasserman Schultz can say, well, you know, whatever I word you want to call it, justice involved. That's what Hillary Clinton is. They don't want to call people criminals. They don't want to say that it's an investigation, you know, it's a security review. They're not criminals. They're now justice-involved individuals, according to the Obama administration. Last couple of weeks, they've been floating that stuff out there. What happens when the criminals start locking up the people who enforce our laws? That's what we're looking at in Arizona. That's what I was talking about earlier about Sheriff Arpaio, that the Obama administration has been coming after since as soon as they took office, because it's always been about opening up the borders. And they point out many times, you know, this is a guy who's been running every 4 years or so, winning by double-digit margins. And we've got a guy there who's a supervisor, and he says, ultimately, what's going to happen, he says, the irony is that while citizens pay the bill for the sheriff's violations of previous court orders, the citizens are the only ones who can remove him from office and restore professionalism to our law enforcement agency. Well, why is it, county supervisor? Why do you think they keep electing him by double-digit margins? Is it because they want to protect the community? We've got the ACLU saying somebody's got to protect the community. We need strong remedies to protect the community's rights. Well, I think the community is electing the sheriff and saying, we have a right to be a community. We have a right to be protected and make sure that we don't have criminals coming into this area. And we have a right to have our laws enforced. And these are state laws that he is enforcing here. And they come in and they say, well, you know, you're being racist because you're picking up Hispanics. They always are the ones who, as soon as we say we want to control illegal immigration, they're the ones who immediately say, you're talking about Hispanics. Well, yeah, that's the way it works out. It's mostly people who are coming through the southern border are Hispanic, but that doesn't mean that we're against Hispanics. We're against illegal immigration. In the same way that the Justice Department comes in, now calling people justice-involved individuals, saying that we can't discriminate against them if we want to rent our homes to them. If we do that, then we are discriminating against blacks and Hispanics if we discriminate against felons. And you have to ask, okay, where does this discrimination come from? Is this discrimination that's in the Justice Department because they're locking up a large percentage of blacks and Hispanics? Are they the ones who are discriminating? Well, if they're the ones who are discriminating, then it's their problem, isn't it? But when we look at this and they tell us these are dangerous people and we're not discriminating against them, and then we say, well, I don't want a dangerous person living in my duplex with me, as I did with my aunt and uncle, killing them. Eventually, it's a rapist, but they didn't know that he was a convicted felon. But now you can find that stuff out, but they don't want you to look at that because these are just people who are justice-involved individuals. They want to do a blanket amnesty to restore their voting rights in Virginia. And, of course, that's Terry McAuliffe, somebody who's been connected with the Clintons for a very long time. They play the race card against these people when they want to. They play the race card against us when they want to. But if they're the ones who are locking up these people because they're black or Hispanic, then it's their problem. They're the racists. But if they're knocking them up for what they did, we should be able to discriminate against their actions. We need to not be cowed down into submission with these labels that they use. And Debbie Wasserman Schultz was just the best example of that, which says, whatever I word you want to use, she's not being investigated. This isn't a criminal investigation. It's like baloney. Baloney. Look at this. We've got, we had just last week, we had the former governor of Pennsylvania, who's going to chair the Democrat convention, saying, we're going to have a convention. Bernie Sanders' name is going to be put into nomination. He's going to lose the vote. And then those Bernie supporters need to behave themselves. Now, we've got another example of this happening on Saturday in Las Vegas. You've got the story from the American Mirror that was on the Drudge Report. We need a medic. Hillary, Bernie, delegates clash at the Nevada Democrat convention, okay, in Las Vegas. And they're duking it out, fighting it out there. Wait a minute. Isn't that those race-baiting conservatives? No, there weren't any of them there, okay? Isn't it Donald Trump's fault? Isn't it Trump supporters? Aren't those people racist? Aren't they the ones who are creating the violence? No, no. It's the Democrats fighting amongst themselves. It's the Bernie Sanders supporters attacking people, attacking Hillary Clinton and the Democrats because they realize how the system is rigged. That's another aspect of this. But nevertheless, they feel just like any communist students. They feel that the end always justifies the means. They don't hesitate to use violence. And that is what they've been doing at the Trump rallies. We have documented that with InfoWars reporters at all these various locations time and again. And now we're seeing it within the Democrat conventions exactly who is to blame. And I wonder if we'll get an apology from Ted Cruz, who threw Trump supporters and Donald Trump under the bus, or the mainstream media. No, we're not going to. No, we're not going to. Let's go back to this report, as I've got a couple of people queuing up here to talk. I wanted to cover what happened with this synthetic DNA that they're working on here. It's such a large issue, and it really is where everything is coming together. We've got not only a Brave New World aspect of it, we've also got Plato's Republic aspect here, okay? So I guess we could call it the Brave New Republic that they're trying to create, where they want to carefully engineer society, all the way down to engineering the individual. And, of course, controlling you from birth. That's why they have to destroy the family. But let's start at the very top here, real briefly. I want to run through a couple of articles here. And as we've pointed out time and again, we had at the end of the week last week, Senator Sessions on USA Today wrote another op-ed piece. He says, this election offers a simple choice. For the first time in a long time, this November will give Americans a clear choice on perhaps the most important issue facing our country and our civilization. whether we can remain a nation state that serves its own people, or whether we slide irrevocably toward a soulless globalism that treats humans as interchangeable widgets in the world market. He said, in Donald Trump, we have a forceful advocate for America. In Hillary Clinton, we have a committed globalist. And there's only one sure way to defeat some of these instruments they have, he points out, the TPP. And he's done a great job of breaking that down, analyzing that for the public. Most people don't pay any attention. We've tried to cover it as much as we can here. Mainstream media doesn't talk about it at all, except to call it free trade. It's not free trade. This is something that's being put together by traitors, T-R-A-I-T-O-R-S. Clinton's extremist proposals, writes Senator Sessions, economically target our poor African-American and Hispanic communities, whose wages and job prospects are being steadily eroded by the huge influx of new foreign workers. Do you understand that? The people who are, we're told, oh, if you're against open borders, then you are racist. You don't like African-Americans and Hispanics. It's like, you understand. They're the ones who are going to be hurt first and hurt the hardest with open borders. And that's just the economic aspects of it. That's not looking at the terrorists that come in, the drug cartels that are given free rein to come across our border and do whatever they wish. Stay with us when we come back. We're going to talk about what's going on in the EU. The former mayor of London, Boris Johnson, points out the same thing I said last week. They fought wars to stop Hitler. Now they're going to get a EU superstate with Germany at the top. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to go to our callers here in just a moment. Alex, Jack, others, I'm going to be with you in just a moment. Before I do, I want to cover a couple of pieces of news that I was referring to just before we went to break. Also, I want to let you know that Vitamin Mineral Fusion is back in stock. This is our drink mix. It's a multivitamin formulation, and I personally prefer to take my nutrients not in pill form, but in something that I can drink. And this is a great way to do it. Great tasting. It's what you just put this mix in with water, and you can get all of your multivitamin needs right there. It's a full month supply of essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids. This is something that we introduced not too long ago, and it sold out immediately, and it's been out of stock for a couple of months, and we now have it back in stock, a limited run, and you can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, we still have, for our best-selling InfoWars Select Storable Foods, still have for a few of those select foods, the best-selling ones, 30 to 40% off. It's a great time to stock up on these made in the USA, non-GMO, shelf life of 25 years at 30 to 40% off at InfoWarsStore.com. Get it before they pull it. It's not going to last much longer. They've already pulled the vast majority. It used to be everything, all of our select storable foods. Now it's just the best-selling products there, so it's not going to last much longer. Before I go to the callers real quickly, just as we went to break, I was talking about what happened last week. You had David Cameron saying, if Britain leaves the EU, and of course there's going to be a vote at the end of June, June 23rd, I think is the date that's coming up. He says, if Britain votes to leave the EU, it could lead to war. And when he said that last week, I said, well, that's interesting, because Britain fought two wars to keep what is happening in Europe from happening. And that is the consolidation of Europe into a monolithic nation state controlled by the Germans. German hegemony, okay? And you now have, at the end of the week, you had Boris Johnson say the same thing. He said the EU wants a super state the same as Hitler did. He says, it was a dramatic interview with The Telegraph. Boris Johnson, former mayor of London, warns that while bureaucrats in Brussels are using different methods from the Nazi dictator, yeah, it's a soft tyranny. This is they laid this out, folks, 10 years after World War II. At the place where the Nazis had their last victory was where they had the first Bilderberg meeting, where they plotted to have a common currency that other people had been talking about, a European superstate, for a long time. How can we bring this together into a political union? Well, the key to all of that is to do an economic union first. And then when you have economic problems, you just say, well, we need more sovereignty. So you have to surrender your national sovereignty so we can make this EU currency work. That's what they're doing now. And when you have people like Boris Johnson, who Obama went over there and said, oh, you know what? If you guys leave, you're going to be at the back of the line when it comes to trade deals. Boris Johnson clearly was very clear when he said, we don't have any control over what's going on now. The trade deals are being negotiated by people in Brussels. Whether it's Brussels or whether it's Berlin, what difference does it make? Yeah, out? What difference does it make? Because you're going to have, you're going to lose your sovereignty. You're going to lose control over your economy. That's what all of these supranational globalist methods of, whether it's a treaty or whether they're consolidating these different countries into a super state, that's the purpose. You lose control. You lose self-determination. You have no control over your economy. You begin to lose your civil rights charters. You have no way of enforcing them. Other people distant from you are going to control you and your family. He also points out, he's a keen classical scholar. He argues the past 2,000 years of European history have been characterized by repeated attempts to unify Europe under a single government in order to recover the continent's lost golden age under the Roman Empire. He says Napoleon, Hitler, various people tried this out, and it always ends tragically. And we are in the early stages of the tragedy of the European central state. But look at what's happening. Also last week, we had news. This is a story from New American. EU is building a potentially tyrannical military police force. As the European Union and the establishment behind it become increasingly totalitarian, paranoid, and unstable. Those always go together, don't they? The more totalitarian a government becomes, the more paranoid it becomes, and the more unstable it becomes, and the more ruthless it becomes. They say the EU superstate is raising up and training its own transnational military police force. The EU Gendarmerie, as the force is known, will apparently be charged with putting down protests, civil unrest, raiding illegal political meetings, propping up foreign governments, even confiscating weapons. But here's the deal. It's not just people in Europe. They're also bringing in people, the police force, from Africa, from the Middle East, from outside of Europe. That's the way they always run this. They always like to have a military control that is not the same as the indigenous people. That's the way you get them to be ruthless, because they might back off and not do it to their own people. And where are they having these training operations? Well, where else? Germany. Even though Germany has a prohibition in their constitution to using military forces for police duties. But you know what? We have that same kind of prohibition, but it doesn't stop us in America either, does it? We have all kinds of prohibitions. We have the 10th Amendment. We've got the Posse Comitatus Law. But it doesn't matter. They just do whatever they wish. And then they talk, and when they put out their video, they ask, how do police forces prepare for managing international crises? Well, you know, when you look at that kind of stuff, you understand then, of course, that the police are really being used as a military. This is the merging of police and military. And to make it even more clear, they say in this 2013 video they put out, the EUPST is a European Union project co-financed by the European Union. But it also includes forces from the African Union, other countries contributing to common security and defense policy missions. Their motto, one language, one common procedure. You see, this is about world government, folks. This is where it's headed. Now, what's happening in the United States? Of course, we have our transatlantic, our trans-Pacific partnerships, been negotiated without the involvement of our elected officials, now being rammed down without regard to constitutional procedures. We have Senator Sessions warning us about that, saying, if we do this, we are going to lose our sovereignty, and he's absolutely clear. But look at this article. This is from someone who is writing he wrote in the New York Times. This is an op-ed piece that the New American analyzes. Somebody who works for the Council on Foreign Relations, his name is Parag Khanna. He is a CFR globalist, self-styled leading global strategist. He says, the problem is we need to get rid of all of these state governments within the United States. Replace the states with regions, with regional governments. Does that sound familiar? All you people who are out there paranoid saying, hey, we get callers all the time. Hey, I'm coming in from FEMA Region 9 is where I'm coming in from. Look, that's exactly what they're calling for. They openly talk about it now. They deny it. They call you conspiracy theorists, but then they put it out there. He says, unfortunately, the problem with America, we need a new map for America, he says. American policy is still wedded to an antiquated political structure of 50 distinct states. Why are we wedded to that structure of 50 distinct states? Well, because we have this thing called a constitution, which you probably think is also antiquated. And our government was created by those 50 states. and in many ways should be subordinate to them if we follow the Constitution. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to go to your calls. Alex in New York and others. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. As we were just talking in the last section, we were talking about the New American's article, CFR Globalists, and of course that's the Council on Foreign Relations, the organization that Ted Cruz's wife worked for, talking about North American Union issues, having a common border around the U.S., Canada, and Mexico that would be patrolled by Homeland Security. That was the recommendation from the council that Heidi Cruz is on. But of course we're told that North American Union doesn't exist. We have articles that are mocking it from the very New York Times that then goes back and publishes an op-ed piece from Parag Khanna, somebody who works for the CFR, talking about how we can create a North American Union. Because he's talking about replacing, he says, you know, the problem is we've got this anachronism of 50 states throughout the Union, throughout the throughout America. And he says we need to turn these into regional areas of government. And, of course, understand when he talks about this, these regions are not just going across state lines or combining states. It also goes across what are now national lines. He talks about having a Detroit-Windsor region. In other words, going between Detroit and Windsor in Canada, creating that as an economic region. He's talking about North American Union. But, of course, the same newspaper that puts his op-ed pieces out there laughs at the conspiracy theorists who want to talk about North American Union, saying things like they did back in 2007. The New York Times said, maybe if you haven't heard about the North American Union, that may be because its plotters have succeeded in keeping a secret, they said back then. Or, more likely, it's because there is no such thing. Government officials say a continental union is out of the question. Oh, really? Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah, we've seen that over and over again. And now when they come out and propose it in the same paper that is mocking that. It's interesting that this weekend we had here in Texas, the Republican Party convention, as Matt Drudge put on the Drudge Report, they came within two votes of bringing up secession on the floor of the Republican convention here in Texas to have 4,000 delegates talk about it. And, of course, the establishment politicians and the Republican Party poo-poo that. They don't like that idea. Of course they don't. They want consolidation. That's where their power is. But the people want to have self-determination. This is what the Texas National Movement's president said. He said, we want Texas to become an independent state, and it's not that far-fetched of an idea. The idea that people have the right of self-determination and that places like Texas can assert their right of self-determination and become independent nation states is not that odd at all. So at the same time, you've got all these people who are promoting the idea that the Ukraine should be able to secede from the Soviet Union. But then Crimea should not be able to secede from the Ukraine, okay? They support the idea of the Declaration of Independence where we seceded from Great Britain, but then nobody else should be able to secede later or today. You know, it's interesting. In 1776, I went up, looked up the population figures. There was 2.5 million people in the United States in 1776. In Texas today, Texas alone, 26 million people, more than 10 times the number of people that were in all of the continental United States at the time we seceded from the British Empire. I think we could go it alone. I think we should. Okay, let's go to Alex in New York. Maybe he doesn't agree with that. You want to talk about the New World Order? Go ahead, Alex.
Hi. I wanted to talk about in Herkimer, there was a killing with the guy. He shot a couple of people.
Okay.
And the first victim is the guy who lived in my house.
Hmm.
And I think that's like a death threat to me.
You're getting death threats?
Yes. Well, it's not like death threats, but, well, I see Obama, he followed me to Florida.
Obama followed you?
Yeah, to Florida.
Barack Obama followed you.
Well, he didn't follow me, but I was working over there in a big hotel, well, in a big house,
mm-hmm.
and he went to the hotel over there.
Oh, okay.
And I seen some of those agents, his agents. One of them had a big tattoo on his chest. Is a pyramid tattoo.
Okay.
And another guy, he had Department of Homeland Security on the beach, and then he took it off, the shirt and put it upside down, and I took a picture of him, but the Homeland Security was upside down.
Well, yeah, there's things like that that are happening. I've got a lot of callers. I want to move on to somebody. Thanks, Alex. Let's go to Jack in New York. Jack, you want to talk about Ron Paul. Go ahead.
Yeah, hi, David. I just want to first say that I appreciate your cogent reportage every day and listening to you.
Well, thank you.
Every time you're on, it's really good. But my point about Ron Paul is I've been very disappointed with his positions as of late, for instance. You know, I voted for Ron Paul in a couple of elections, but lately he's shown himself to be anti-constitutional in a sense that he includes the fascist corporatocracy and their spying and censure of private individuals' posts, like on Facebook, as if they're protected from, you know, being regulated by the government. When they have contracts, you know, with the, our government.
So, oh, so he defended Facebook monitoring people. Was that?
And so my point is that you know, the concept of corporate personhood is not constitutional at all. Mm-hmm. So corporations do not have the same protections as individuals do under our Constitution, our national constitution. And, you know, if the government is supporting Facebook through their, our tax dollars, this is a kind of a, to me, it's kind of a strict, dumb constitutionalist position that's really not constitutional at all, and it really distorts real constitutional patriotism.
Well, I think the problem comes in is when we move from the abstract to the concrete and when we ignore the details. For example, if we look at Facebook and we look at the connections that they've had with different politicians and we see what they're doing with conservatives, we understand that this isn't simply a pure exercise of private property rights. They're being used as a tool of control. And the same thing is true when we go in and we have people, many that I agree with on many, many issues, but oftentimes we'll see libertarians who'll come in and support free trade and principle. And I understand free trade and principle. And of course, Ron Paul has come out in the past talking about NAFTA. And he says, look, NAFTA is not free trade. If it was free trade, you wouldn't need thousands of pages of a trade agreement to enforce this. This is managed trade. It's corporate trade. And he's pointed that out when it comes to NAFTA and other issues. But you still have a lot of people who are Republicans or label themselves as conservatives or libertarians who will support these trade treaties pretending that they are free trade. Ted Cruz is an example of one of those individuals. It is not free trade. It is managed trade. And it is corporate crony capitalism. It is and if you don't pay attention to what the end game is or what the mechanisms are here, and you just tell people that this is free trade, then that is something that certainly in the case of people with the Trans-Pacific Partnership and other issues like that, that Ted Cruz has come in, he knows what's involved in that. And so what he's doing is he's using language in the same way that the Democrats use these dog whistles of race and culture to mask their real agenda. The Republicans use the language of free trade and private property sometimes to mask what is really going on between government and corporations and with the military-industrial complex, not looking at the actual mechanism that is being set up. That's why I really appreciate what Senator Sessions is doing. Your comments, Jack.
Well, you know, part of the problems we're having right now in our country is the fact that
we've got about 10 people, seconds. Okay. Got about 10 seconds, so wrap it up.
Looking to the federal government for everything.
That's right.
You know, it just isn't constitutional when you do that. So when you protect, you know, Google and you know, all these other corporations under the guise of individual rights, it just doesn't work.
I agree. Thank you so much, Jack. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to take more calls. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to go back to our callers. Going to go to Gene in New Mexico first. Before I do, real quickly, I want to cover what got me so upset over this weekend. I haven't even talked about it in detail yet. And that is the efforts to create synthetic DNA. And I got to tell you that this concerns me far more than any escalation of the Soviet Union with the revival of the Cold War. This is far more dangerous than that. And I'll tell you exactly why. Before I do, real quickly, what funds our operation is your support. And we try to offer you products that we use ourselves that help our health, things that will help your health. Now we have back in stock Vitamin Mineral Fusion. That's a drink mix that we sell here. It is a multivitamin. In that one container there, you get a full month's supply of essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids. You can mix that with water and you just drink it. You don't have any pills that you have to take. I don't like taking pills. Of course, one of my favorite supplements is Brain Force. I do take pills, but I like to get things that I can just drink, that I don't have a bunch of pills to swallow. This is the platinum standard of multivitamin products. It tastes great. And it's very easy to take this and to for your body to assimilate it because it's in a liquid format. Again, it's now back in stock. It's been sold out for quite a while after our initial run. That is Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink. And that is at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, we have 30 to 40% off the best-selling of the InfoWars Select Storable Foods. It used to be everything that was there. We had that massive sell. We've had to cut it back to just the best sellers. And that's not going to last for very much longer. 30 to 40% off the retail price of InfoWars Select Storable Food. That's a shelf life of 25 years, non-GMO food, all made in the USA, and the best packaging you're going to find in storable foods. Now, real quickly, before I go back to the callers, this article that came out of the New York Times, it was on the Drudge Report, scientists talking privately about creating a synthetic human genome. I need you to understand the implications of this technology, where this is headed. The danger of this. They say scientists are now contemplating the fabrication of a human genome, meaning they would use chemicals to manufacture all the DNA contained in human chromosomes. Now, this is a follow-up to the Human Genome Project. You remember that? You had the scientists with the money from the government's large research project where they went in and they analyzed the human DNA. They sequenced the DNA genome. So basically what they were doing is studying it, analyzing it, trying to figure out what the different components were. Now they're at the point where they want to build it from the ground up. That means you're not going to have father and mother. This is beyond Brave New World, where they went in and they had the hatcheries, where they would create the eggs, where they would multiply them out, separate them out so they would have different strata of society. Remember, they had the alpha, the betas, the gammas, deltas, the epsilons. Some of them they would withhold oxygen from so that they were mentally deficient, crippled in other ways. Then they would have the others that they would enhance. Then they would follow that up with training, special training. So they had this stratified, government-controlled world government. But of course, it goes all the way back to Plato. And if you look at the elements that all these different social engineers have, you have the elements of a rigid class society. It was Plato didn't have the alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilons. He had the philosopher kings. He had the guardians. He had the people who served them. They also had a crude kind of eugenics even back then, where they would say, well, we don't want the children to know who their family is. So we're going to create this hedonistic society where everybody is having these orgies. Nobody knows who their parents are, so that the only mother and father they know is the state. But then, of course, if they wanted to have a kind of crude eugenics, they would drug certain individuals, make sure that they made it, and then follow the offspring, take that offspring for a particular purpose. And then at the very bottom of this, of course, was education. If you want to destroy the society, you don't blow it up with bombs. You had Obama's mentor realize that, Bill Ayers from the Weathermen. Okay, he stopped bombing society. And what he did to really destroy, to deconstruct and destroy our society was to get into education. That's where he's been hanging out for decades. And that, of course, is where Obama is now focused, on education, with the Department of Education doing the types of things to reorganize society. But when you get to the point that they can go in and they can synthesize individuals, what are they going to do? Are they going to, as the article points out, are they going to make copies of specific people? Are they going to create special super soldiers, people that are bred to be that? Are they going to, as one person who blew the whistle on this said, would it be okay, for example, to sequence and then synthesize Einstein's genome and then maybe train him in your schools to make him evil, okay? Unlike the original Einstein. Now, he exposed this, but the guy who put this together at Harvard Medical School, George Church, says, no, there's just a misunderstanding. This wasn't aimed at creating people, just at creating cells. Well, you know what? Let's not quibble over semantics. That is what they were trying to do. They called it, to start out, the Human Genome Project 2, HGP2, the Human Genome Synthesis Project. They said it was going to be an invitation to meeting at Harvard, so the primary goal would be to synthesize a complete human genome in a cell line within a period of 10 years. This is very concerning, folks. I mean, going back to, you know, this is like Jurassic Park, really, but far worse, because it combines the, they're not creating dinosaurs, okay? They're creating a monstrous society here. Brave New World is far scarier than Jurassic Park. And it is something that threatens our society far more. And if we go back and we look at this, at the very end of this article, one of the guys makes this statement. He says, our ability to understand what to build is so far behind what we can build. I just don't think that being able to make more and more and more and cheaper and cheaper and cheaper is going to get us the understanding we need. Well, you know, Michael Crichton, as a writer, put it much more succinctly. He said, just because you can build it, doesn't mean you should. And they say, well, we went through and we looked at the ethics behind this. You are making this determination without the rest of us being involved in this. And this is, the ethical considerations are far different than the technical considerations. And this is something we need to understand, how this fits into this kind of scheme that the New World Order, that the globalist elite have had for 2,400 years, going all the way back to Plato, going through Aldous Huxley. They want to engineer society, and they want to create the individuals that are going to give them empowerment and control. All right, I want to get back to our callers. We've got just a little bit of time. Let's go to Gene in New Mexico. Go ahead, Gene.
Hello, David. I have some vital information for you. In case I get cut off, I could always stay online and share it with your reporters what my best friend who passed away of cancer told me. My friend was a former gay and lesbian activist from 1990 to 2000, and he told me what's behind the bathroom war. Now, I know that Alex has mentioned before, how come, you know, no one says anything about homosexuals having their head chopped off overseas. That is what got him fired. He brought that up to them in 2000. Mm-hmm. And when he told the GLBT, how come we don't do anything for the homosexuals overseas? And they told him, sir, we only concentrate in U.S. issues. Overseas issues are none of our concern.
Except the Saudis are one of our closest allies, and so you would think that we would have something to say about that. We have had things to say about human rights abroad over and over again. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so basically he said, okay, so if I live in Saudi Arabia and I'm gay and they chopped off my head, you're not going to do anything about it? And that's when they told him, you know what, sir? We don't need your services anymore. You're fired. He also brought up the attention. He was against gay and lesbian marriage. He says that the government shouldn't be in your business trying to marry you.
Yes.
He was against that.
Yes.
They saw my friend as too conservative, even though he was gay. They saw that he was too conservative. Now, the issue with the bathroom thing, I'm going to tell you what he told me. Just like 9/11 was used to strip our liberties, the whole thing with the bathroom is this. It's being put as a transgender issue, but that's a decoy. It's not about transgenders, because this is what he told me. My friend was not only an activist, he was also a psychologist, and he worked in human resources. And he told me, look, transsexuals, their number one mission is to look as much as a woman as possible and blend in into society. For decades, they use the bathroom, and they have never gone to the government to demand that they use that bathroom. It's not about them. The GLBT was taken over by the government.
Yes, I agree, and we're out of time. And I would point out, too, when you look at Target, understand that Target, a year ago, said they're going to remove all gender signs, and Target has been used with the government as essentially a Sherlock Holmes organization. They know how to data mine things better than anyone else. Who better to give them feedback on how their social engineering is working? Think about that. when you go shopping. Think about what Target is doing. Look, we're out of time today. Sorry I didn't have more time. Gene, join us tomorrow, 11 a.m.